of Sutton Coldfield, who shared the same dream, to be the best rock and roll band in the world. This is their story, or journey, as it likes to be called these days. All the events in this documentary are true, although may have been slightly exaggerated, especially the bit about the three number ones and Paul dating Britt Eklund.
Where's the most famous number 10 in the world? Downing Street? Not on your Nelly, say Liverpudlians. It's 10 Matthew Street, the address of The Cavern, where the Beatles took the pop world by storm. Others have since used it to make a Merseysound stay world famous.
After visiting the Cavern Club, the boys were bitten by the rock and roll bug. Matt turned to Paul and said, "One day we're going to be just like the Beatles." Paul replied, "Bagsby the one who doesn't get shot." The boys went away, bought themselves second-hand guitars, and the journey began. After months of practicing and writing songs, the time felt right to go public. After a chance meeting with Cilla Black, the boys got their first gig, a late-night slot going on after Jerry and the Pacemakers. All did not go according to plan. Paul recalls, "I remember that night. Jerry and the Pacemakers were so bad, people were still booing halfway through our set." As luck would have it, the legendary producer George Marden was in the audience. He remembers, "Although they couldn't sing in tune and the songs weren't very good, I thought they could have a future in pop music." George took them under his wing, and after several sessions in the studio, the band released their first single, "She Likes You Quite a Lot, Yes, Yes, Yes." The single flopped. The band released two more singles, the subliminal drug message, "Demerara Sugar," and capturing the mood of the contemporary folk scene, "Moving Around in a Breeze." Like the first single, they both flopped. The boys couldn't understand it. They turned to George Martin for advice. "Stop copying other bands," was his reply. The boys went away, and for 3 months wrote and wrote and wrote, and played Zabudio. They changed their name from the Cockroaches to the Baubles, and with the help of George Martin, who was now out of hospital after suffering a breakdown, started playing the local clubs. Word got around about this new band, and it wasn't long before they came to the attention of Noel Gallagher.
You know, and then you learn to play those songs and you think, wow, they're so simple, but it's the melodies they were coming up with on top of that and the chord changes. And then that quickly became an obsession.
Now was the time to capitalise. The boys released four of the best-selling albums of the decade. Birmingham Rhapsody, English Twit, Baubles on the Run, and the infamous Let It Lie. The Baubles had made it big. The Mudfather himself, Paul Weller, became a follower.
Altered the planet, really. Certainly altered my planet, that's for sure. And then once I saw them, I just wanted to do music, you know. They made me want to pick up a guitar in the first place, you know.
The dream had been realised, but with it came the inevitable problems. Cracks started appearing in the relationship. Matt wanted more input into the music. In fact, some input into the music. Egos clashed and the Baubles split. It was devastating for their legion of fans. Paul ventured out on a successful solo career, headlining the prestigious Jersey Hotel Festival. Matt went back to being a stunt double for Dr. Hillary. Paul's behaviour became more and more erratic. He was often seen dressed as a pirate and mixing with like-minded fantasists and with the in-crowd of the day. His attention turned briefly to coke, but after two bottles he felt bloated and gassy and didn't try it again. He needed focus, and after a high-powered meeting at Moore Hall, the boys decided to reform, and with the guidance of legendary record producer Steve Muff Hemming, they released the critically acclaimed album Born to Jog. The magic was still there. Shane McGowan recalls what he liked about the Baubles. Their next three singles all charted as Christmas number ones.
Why have the church bells stopped ringing? Why don't snowflakes still fall? Why, since the day that you went away, Christmas?
I lifted up the bag to see what I could see, but I ain't no mechanic, they all seem to be. So
let's all join hands together for Christmas. Every man and woman, boy and girl, let's all join hands together for Christmas. And together we can make a better world.
The Baubles were back. Over the next 3 years, the boys produced arguably their three most accomplished albums. From the raunchy punk-orientated Never Mind the Bullocks, through to the superb concept album Kesterton Road, the rise and fall and rise of the Baubles was complete. So that's the story so far. Two boys, one dream, zero talent. So while their fans eagerly await the release of this year's Christmas single, One More Christmas Alone, we leave you with the words of legendary rock god and lifelong Baubles fan, Liam Gallagher, summing up what the Baubles mean to him.
You know, what can I say? I'm not going to hide it. I love them. They make me happy. They make me, you know. And I think they're the best and still are. And I think to learn, if you're going to be as good, you've got to learn from the best, and they're the best.